chapter 7. So we read in verse 1, after a busy week, God rested. This is repeated in verse 2, so God is keen that we should understand the need for rest. In the Old Testament, people were allowed to rest on the Sabbath as part of the law introduced by Moses. Before the coming of Christ, the law required strict observance of the Sabbath. However, Jesus fulfilled all the requirements of the law, so we are released from this. Nevertheless, God's design is for us to have rest built in, and we ignore this at our peril. In verse 7, we read that God used his breath to bring the first man to life one day, and then took a breather the next. So Adam's first day was one of rest. God didn't need the rest, but he knows we do. God formed his body from the dust of the ground. Then he breathed into him the breath of life. And Adam came alive. He became a living creature. Revelation 4:11 says that we are created for his good pleasure. We give him joy not as inanimate objects, but as living, breathing beings. And his breath is essential for that purpose. So there are three components for all of humanity: dust, the breath of God, and life. And we'll have a look at each of those together. Dust to begin with. God created man out of the most basic elements, the dust of the ground. There is nothing spectacular in what we are made of, only in the way those basic things are organized. When the Bible uses dust in a figurative or symbolic sense, it means something of little worth, associated with lowliness and humility. For example, in Genesis 18:27, Abraham says, "I will speak to the Lord, I who am but dust and ashes." In the Bible, dust isn't evil, and it isn't nothing, but it's next to nothing. So without God's breath, we don't amount to much, to anything, in fact. So let's have a look at breath. Breath is fundamental to our continued existence. A baby's first action on leaving the womb is to breathe. When we die, we breathe our last. It is impossible for us to perform any function without breath in our lungs. It facilitates our communication, enables us to speak and sing, allows us to express our emotions, oxygenates our blood, which feeds our brain. There are many verses about God breathing life into people. Let's have a look at a couple. Job 33, verse 4. The Spirit of God has made me, and the breath of the Almighty gives me life. And in Psalm 104, verse 29, when he takes away their breath, they die and turn again to dust. When he gives them his breath, life is created, and he renews the face of the earth. Now, the Spirit of God can be a difficult concept to grasp. In verse 26 of the previous chapter, God says, "Let us make man in our image." So he took the most prosaic material, dust, to make the physical body, and his spirit to give life. His spirit then is expressed pictorially as breath. In 1 Corinthians 25, Paul reflects on this passage. He surmises that if there is a natural body, then there is also a spiritual body. The first man was of the dust of the earth. The second man, Jesus, is of heaven. And just as we bear the image of the earthly man, so shall we also bear the image of the heavenly man. The Hebrew word for God's spirit is ruach, with a ch. The Greek is pneuma, from where we get pneumatic. Both mean wind, breath, and spirit. God's breath gives us a spirit. We become both body and soul, both carnal and spiritual. It is his spirit we receive. It is by the giving of his spirit that we are made in his image. We can see this by Jesus breathing on the disciples in the upper room after his resurrection for them to receive the Holy Spirit as a constant indwelling. Lastly, life. Without breath, we're just a shell, a husk, flesh and bone, a few chemicals and predominantly water. But we are also more than living bipeds. We have a soul, one that is eternal. God's plan from the start involved a living creature. Jesus came into the world as a human being, a living, breathing individual. He took his first breath in an animal enclosure in Bethlehem and his last breath on the cross. But his spirit, of course, did not die. He rose again in his resurrection body. This chapter shows that the creation of humanity took place once the cosmos had been established. Our world was made for us and we for it. Our salvation and God's joy come directly from God's actions. On the seventh day, God took a breather. But we learn from Hebrews 7:25 that Jesus is even now at the right hand of the Father, constantly interceding on our behalf. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to him through God. Sorry, those who draw near to God through him. And that, my friends, is the really good news.